This could be the most important program of your whole life. Listen to me. This program has to do with your family and what's going to happen to it. What can happen to your children, your grandchildren, even your great-grandchildren. I cannot tell you how important this program is to you. Early this morning, when I was praying over our time here, the Holy Spirit really spoke to me and said, pray with Sarah, because there are going to be some very special miracles that will come out of this time of teaching on generation blessing. So I encourage you, you know, stay right there, hang right in tight, and keep open about how God is going to talk to you about your family, because we're going to be ministering to you about generation blessing, one of the most important things of your whole life.
And Mom, I think it's very essential for us to consider generation blessing, because when you look at the way God moves, God doesn't do like hiccups in time. You know, I mean, it's start, stop, start. The thing that's so fantastic about God and watching what he's done throughout history is the continuity. And you see him, and it says this, I love this in Psalms when he says, one generation declares the glories of God to the next generation. And so that's very much a continuity. And you may be watching right now, and maybe there's some struggles that are happening in your family with your kids or your parents, grandkids or your grandparents. And maybe you're concerned about them not serving God. Well, I want to encourage you to get on the website. Leave their names there, because we want to pray for them, that God would really move into their hearts and rescue them from some bad decisions, and also that they would have a relationship, a vibrant relationship with God. And Mom, I recently did a parenting class, and it was very, very powerful to me. And God spoke to me and said, you know, Sarah, I don't have grandchildren. God doesn't have grandchildren. And meaning this, just because you're saved doesn't necessarily qualify me to get in and just follow just because of who you are. That I have to work out my own salvation with fear and trembling. And I'm responsible myself. And so you may be watching right now and you're concerned about your kids and them not knowing Christ. Or maybe you're watching, you're thinking, oh, I didn't realize just because we do the cultural thing and we're religious and we go to church, it doesn't automatically transfer to your kids. In fact, Mom, this is very essential in America. Statisticians tell us that the number of Christians in America is significantly declining as you look through the generations. And so this day is a very essential day. And we're talking about generation blessing, and I'm talking about it a lot in the sense of our kids serving God and knowing God and loving God. But generation blessing, Mom, also deals with some physical things.
Yes.
It deals with emotional things.
Very.
It deals with, I think this is an interesting concept to consider. You have an ability with language. You studied Latin and Spanish and French.
Right.
And I have an ability. And I texted you the other day. I was in my Hebrew class, and I was like, I'm really good at this. And I loved it.
That was
like,
sweet.
Wow, how cool is that?
Loved it.
And I'm watching my daughter, and she's kind of bending and enjoying some of the language. And so those generation blessings, that's something that's a very powerful, powerful thing. And Mom, talk to us a little bit biblically where we see this.
Well, I want to talk about both, Sarah. I want to talk about the curse.
Yep.
Because it says the iniquities of the fathers are visited upon the children to the third and fourth generation.
What's an iniquity?
An iniquity is like a sin that is practiced until it becomes a habit, or a trespass that is practiced until it becomes a habit. Mm. So it's your habits you pass on through the blood.
Right.
So if you sin on an occasion, doesn't mean the child will inherit that you have. But if that sin becomes a habit, or that trespass becomes a habit, then that weakness is passed on through the blood. And so that's a very, very dangerous thing. Mm-hmm. Very dangerous. So an iniquity basically means to bend. They will bend in the direction that you bent in.
Wow.
But in that same scripture, here comes the good news. I know you're thinking, oh, dear Lord. And we can repent of our sins, thank God. We can repent of our trespasses, and we can repent of iniquities, because Jesus took them all. Took your sin, your trespass, your iniquity. He broke the curse. Ooh. And it's broken through faith in his blood. Repentance, putting faith in his blood. But also, the blessing comes through blood also. And that's very key. So everyone watching, you have a DNA that God gave you. You didn't ask for it. It's, I call it designer genes. You came with it, came through the blood. And Sarah shared about the foreign language thing. You know, I never thought necessarily, oh, Sarah's going to be good in foreign languages. I didn't even think enough about that or even to go that direction. So seeing her loving that, and now Isabel, it's so interesting to me about Isabel because she's learning a little bit of Spanish, and she said the other day, tú eres mi abuela, which means you are my grandmother. And I said, tú eres mi nieta, you are my granddaughter. Oh, she really loved that. So then I began to speak a little Spanish. She said, oh, Mimi, I love this. Teach me Spanish. And I thought, what's cooking here? What is it? That's a generation blessing. That's a DNA that's been passed through. And so watch those things that you can begin to see you're strong in that and see if those are in your children. Now, God has a big designer plan for every family. I believe God has a wonderful plan for every family. I don't think anybody's an accident. I think everybody is a divine appointment. And I want to share, Sarah, and jump in on this at any moment, because you share in generation blessing. And you also share in generation weaknesses. You have to watch for physical things that might come from Wally and me and so on. But I want to look in the Bible at how this thing works. And what your decision is today is very, very important. Very important. That's why I opened this program and said, this could be one of the most important programs of your whole life to watch. So we're going to look at a family in the Old Testament, the family of Korah, K-O-R-A-H. And if you're not familiar with Old Testament, don't worry, I'm going to tell you this story. My grandchildren love Old Testament stories. And so I like to share this. But Korah was a family that God had an assignment for. They were assigned to lead worship. So right in the book of Exodus, we began to see the sons of Korah, the family of Korah. They were always in charge of the worship services. So undoubtedly, they had talent with musical instruments, talent to sing, because God wouldn't call you to do something. He didn't give you the genes to go with it. So very, very wonderful. What an assignment. Imagine you led the worship service all the time in the tabernacle. You were always there to lead the people. But the leaders of Korah, Korah himself, began to get critical of Moses and of Aaron. And Moses and Aaron certainly weren't perfect. So they could have been critical. You know, Moses killed a man. Moses hit a rock. I mean, Moses did some things. He wasn't perfect by any means. Certainly Aaron wasn't. He helped make a golden calf. So they're not perfect people, but they're people that God assigned to that position. And it wasn't up to Korah to make a decision to take him out. But he got into rebellion and pride. Ooh, pride's so dangerous and so subtle. And decided he was more spiritual than they were and began to get other people to go with him.
And you know, Mom, just to think about this as a contrast.
Yes.
You know, David, when he was serving Saul, Saul was trying to kill him. Saul was trying, I mean, brutal. Brutal.
Bitter.
And 12 years of chasing David and going after him. But David never disrespected, dishonored Saul. He said, "I, the anointing that is on Saul, I'm never going to touch. How dare we touch the Lord's anointed?" And it's a contrast there. And sometimes I think it's very important for us. Sometimes we can identify either with Korah and say, look, I've got the anointing on me and God's using me.
Talented.
And sometimes, and sometimes those special talents and gifts, musicians sometimes can be that way. Sometimes they can be a little bit of a prima donna. I'm all of that and a bag of chips.
Wow,
I'm this special. And it's interesting because sometimes when the anointing is flowing through you, we have to be very careful that we don't distort the anointing with our own flesh. Mm-hmm. And you see, that's what happens with Korah. And the anointing, you know, leading praise and worship and, wow, experiencing the presence of God. And we can get real addicted to that. But we have to be careful that we don't try and change the anointing, but that we let the anointing change us.
And go for that vision that God has for you and don't pervert the vision. So he got all these other people, because rebellion attracts people.
Yeah, it does.
And he got rebellious people with him. And God really spoke to Moses. And Moses, to me, is so compassionate and merciful. Mm-hmm. And so he really prayed, and God said, I'm going to deal with him, and I'm going to take care of this, and I'm going to open the earth, and I'm going to show a miracle here that they cannot rebel against leadership. So Moses calls Korah, all of his family, all of the people that he had gotten into leadership against Moses and Aaron, to come together. And the most unusual thing happens. The earth opens up and swallows them.
Now, this is in Numbers 26, around verse 11. So people may be watching, Mom, and think, oh, that's kind of weird.
That?
That's crazy. It's Numbers 26, around verse 11, 10, 11, 12, along in there.
Yeah. And Numbers 21 kind of starts it, Sarah. Mm-hmm. So this is in Numbers, this whole account.
Right.
So the earth opens up and swallows all these people. But you say, well, that's the end of the blessing for the family. Because here's his children, his grandchildren will never be involved in worship. That was God's design, plan, talent, and look at them. Because of disobedience, you can miss the blessing. But, oh, I love this. In Numbers 26:11, it says the sons of Korah did not stand with him.
Wow.
They said no. And
they didn't
honored,
follow their dad.
No, they honored God.
You know,
more than their
father.
That
takes a lot of guts to to stand up and say, no, Dad, we're not going to do that.
Right.
No, Dad, we're not. Right. We're not going to be disrespectful of you, but we're not going to disobey God.
And you may be watching this program, and this really stirs you up about your family. So get on the website, leave the names and needs of your family, or write us a letter. Because, folks, remember, God has a plan, a divine plan. And we don't want to be in disobedience, because obedience is going to bring the blessing. And we'll be right back. Stay right there.
Talking about generation blessing here, and oftentimes when we think generation blessing, we think from the father or the mother down to the kids. But check this out. This is a testimony to really encourage you that it's not just, you know, from the top to the, from the parent to the child, but also from the child up to the parent. Watch this. Mary from Pennsylvania, she was struggling because her dad was going to have a surgery and he didn't know Jesus. And so she dropped us a line on the website, and after receiving prayer, she let us know that he not only received the Lord, but the surgery was a complete success. That's
awesome.
Generation blessing. And I really think, Mom, it's so important that we don't always just think of it down to our kids, because we have people who watch right now that don't have children. You know, and maybe they want to have kids, and maybe that's some of the generation blessing that we can pray about for them. But generation blessing doesn't necessarily just have
it's
to come
family.
Down, but it's, yeah, it's family.
Family up and
top
around.
To bottom, bottom to top, whatever.
Around.
Yeah.
It's so important.
Yeah.
And when you read this about the sons of Korah, how they made a decision, obedience is what brings a blessing, and said, no, we're not going to stand with our father. Now, I watch their history, because I don't know how many thousands of years ago we would go back to Moses. What are we looking at? 3,500?
Yeah.
Before Christ, would that
Definitely.
Be right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, now think about this, how long the blessing goes, because when it talks to you, it says 100 generations, so we just kind of fan that away. But watch it is really, really key. So they said, okay, they're to lead the worship. That's their design or plan. And so they, at the tabernacle gates, are the worship leaders. Mm-hmm. Isn't that interesting? So we begin to follow them. And then as we go down through the kings, and we go to David, we have the sons of Korah. So, I mean, that's many years later. The sons of Korah are still in the blessing.
Yeah.
The children are inheriting the blessing. Well, what are they doing? They're doing their DNA, their divine DNA.
Right.
They're leading worship.
Yeah.
Then, it's so fascinating to me that they were given 13 cities when Joshua came in and they took all of the promised land that they took. Well, the sons of Korah come popping up, and they are worship leaders, and they are assigned 13 cities.
Mm.
Awesome. David used them, as I said before, for worship leaders. His son Solomon used them for worship leaders. What's going on? The blessing, the blessing. And we should not just think, well, the blessing is just for me or just for my children.
Right.
But if Jesus tarries, Sarah, the blessing should continue, and that's really God's design or plan. And you opened this program and talked about this, how that Christianity is going downhill.
Yeah. And you know something, Mom, I think this is really powerful. The sons of Korah, they wrote several psalms, but one of the psalms they wrote, Psalms 42. And there's a song that we used to sing way back in the day from the sons of Korah.
Yes.
As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs for you. My soul thirsts for God, the living God. When can I go and meet with God? And I remember, Mom, I remember in my early 20s when I was coming back to Christ. You know, I had my little faith crisis thing and all that. But I remember sitting on this study. You remember the orange carpet?
Yes.
I was sitting on the study, and I was sleeping on the floor with a blanket and a pillow. And I was sitting there, and God was dealing with me and dealing with me. And the verse that God spoke to me again and again and again is in Psalms 42, verse 7. And it says, deep calls to deep, and the roar of your waterfalls. All of your waves and breakers have swept over me. And I remember sitting there, feeling that, sensing that, reading, hearing that in my heart, and feeling literally like the love of God, like waves and breakers just pounding down on me and just, you know, overwhelming me. And I broke down and cried and just softened my heart so deeply, so tenderly, and really said to God, oh. And I remember thinking, how could I have ever left you? How could I have ever turned my back on you? And this verse was an essential core verse, a central verse for God dealing with me and really moving on my heart. And this is from the sons of Korah.
The sons of Korah. And now and listen.
How long ago was that?
Yeah, I mean, we're 2010 or thereabouts after Christ.
Yeah.
If this was written, I don't know, 2,500 years before Christ, do you realize over 5,000 years we have seen this family blessing coming down? So when we get all nervous and think, oh, 100 generations, that can never be. How do you know?
Right.
You're not God. And how do you know how important you are to God? And how he has such a wonderful plan for your family. And so it's not only breaking curses, thank God Jesus took the curse for us, but it's also getting into obedience with the blessing and praying and saying, what is that vision? Now, Sarah, I watch your children. You have three. You want to talk about them a little bit, and then I'll tell you what I watch.
David, Benji, and all in elementary school, kind of close together.
And I watch the things they choose, what they like, because they talk to me, and, you know, I have one at a time over for a date.
Yeah.
And so I'll say, you know, what do you like? What in school is really, you know, where you? And watching their choices, their talents, their successes helps me to know how to pray for them and the DNA that God has for them. So I believe with all my heart, your children, and if Jesus tarries, your grandchildren will serve God, because we've started the blessing and they are going to continue the blessing.
Right.
And what are you doing? You're teaching them obedience.
Yeah.
I mean, all the time obedience. And these sons of Korah, they could have gone under the curse, dropped into the ground and died.
Right. Right. And Mom, I think this is so important to catch, that the sons made a difference, made a distinction, made a choice that was different than what their parents, what their father did. And that's a hard decision. That's extremely hard. And I think in this culture, even more so, because it's very tied into family and knit together and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And when their dad was swallowed up, they didn't stand with their dad. They said, we're not going to do the same thing. And there are people who are watching today, and I encourage you, you may be struggling with some family conflict, and I want to encourage you, first of all, that you are loving. You can disagree, but you don't have to be disagreeable. That we always need to let the love of Christ control our behavior. God dealt with me on that so strongly, 2 Corinthians 5:14, that the love of God controls our behavior. But it doesn't mean that I'm going to follow. If you were doing something that I didn't feel right in my heart,
right.
I have biblical. No, and I have to stand before God. Right. And that's the thing, is that we as individuals, and I can't stand before God and say, well, she told me to do that. That's not going to, I'm responsible for myself and the decisions that I make, and I have to honor God. And so if you have parents or you have kids that are dishonoring God or making ungodly choices, it doesn't mean that you say approve of it, or, you know, but you don't
compromise.
No compromise.
No.
But you can be loving and kind. Mm-hmm. And the love of God draws man. His goodness draws us to repentance. And so maybe by being kind and loving and compassionate, but being firm, gentle but firm, you make choices that say, no, this is the path I believe God has for me. And I believe he wants you to choose the same path. You follow him, but we're still going to follow God. We're going to love God. We're going to serve God. And we're not going to do the things you're doing. I disagree. I disagree with the attitude. I disagree with the conversation. I love Jesus deeply. I love you deeply. But these are areas that are going to be out of bounds. And sometimes we have to do that, Mom.
We have to. And God has given me a scripture for some of you watching about your family right now. Because you feel very defeated by this. You just think it's down the drain. Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute. This program is being stopped because God's hand is on you and your household. And it's 2 Corinthians 2:14. And it says, thanks be to Christ who always leads us to triumph in Christ and through us diffuses the fragrance of his knowledge in every place. Now listen, listen to the Holy Spirit. He's going to lead you into a triumphant place. And you're going to have a smell of victory that will encourage others to believe for their family. So God, don't give up on God with your household. And we have a website you can get on right now. And put the names of your family and your concern. You can write us a letter. You can get on the phone. But don't give up on your family. Don't give up on yourself. You say, well, I have all these weaknesses. Well, so you do. And you say, you know, look at some of my family. You know, I say, everybody's family tree has nuts in it. There's certainly some nuts in mine. But what we choose is to obey what God says. And when you get into that obedience, it brings a blessing. And you may be persecuted, it may be hard, but oh, it pays. When it's paying over 5,000 years later and blessing me, as the dear patent for the water was written by the family of the sons of Korah, I mean, that just really rattles my cage. And I believe it does yours too. So remember, God loves you. He loves your family. Jesus broke the curse through his blood, faith in his blood, and began the blessing through faith in his blood. Family curses are very serious business because they can be mental, emotional, physical, and even spiritual. And it can go from one generation to the next generation. They are generation curses spoken of very clearly in the Old Testament. But Jesus redeemed us from the curse because he became a curse for us. So the good news is that all family curses can be broken. That's right. Mental, emotional, physical, spiritual, they can be broken. And the Bible shows us this so clearly. And who can break the curse? You can by putting your faith in the blood of Jesus Christ. You need to know how to break every kind of curse that is coming against you. You need to, because God's word can set you free and set your family free. But even more than that, and this is so exciting, such exciting news, you can begin the generation blessing, because the power of blessing is greater than the power of curse. The Bible tells us the power of the curse can go to four generations, but oh, the blessing can go to 1,000 generations. And that's so important for you to know today. Not only can all generation curses be broken, but generation blessings can begin with you. And I'm telling you, when you see how to do this, and when you begin to see how it happens in your children and your grandchildren, even your great-grandchildren, it will so bless you, it will change you, it will transform your life. Blessings and curses. We make a choice, and God has given us the provision for bountiful blessing. Everyone wants to know how to. How do you break the curse? How do you impart the blessing? How to is so important. And that's why I'm making my Imparting the Blessing series my special thank you for your gift of any amount this month. It's a 3-CD set of teachings in which I take you to the Word, show you how to break generational curses, and start generational legacy of blessings. Here's more information about this resource and how to get it.
For a limited time, Marilyn Hickey's 3-CD teaching titled Imparting the Blessing is our special thank you for your gift of any amount. As you give, you'll be helping to make it possible to keep this kind of teaching coming to you and to your neighbors and friends. Imparting the Blessing will open your eyes to the reality of generational curses and reveal the very powerful, very biblical keys to living in the freedom and blessings Jesus died to bring us, and show you how to extend that blessing to your family. It's yours right now when you simply call or go online and share a gift of any amount. And if you can plant a seed of $50 or more, we'll also send you Marilyn's eye-opening book, which will take you even higher and deeper into this neglected subject. Finally, if you're able to share a gift of $1,000 or more, we want to express our thanks by sending you a beautifully framed noted page from Marilyn Hickey's Personal Study Bible. Be a vital part of all God is doing through these outreaches and share in the spiritual rewards for every life touched. As you give by phone or online, request these resources on breaking generational curses and get started establishing your own legacy of blessing today.